there was a conflict between, on one side, the physicist who said time is an illusion, on the other hand, the philosophers, or everybody, I mean, just any human being, for whom time is a fundamental dimension, the basic existential dimension. And this is the question which people have asked since the start of rational thought. Now, in modern quantum mechanics, based on Schrödinger, Heisenberg, Dirac, and so on, the basic equation presents a law. There are no events on the basic level. In the orthodox Copenhagen interpretation, we are creating the events by measuring something. So we come again to the idea that we are perturbing a timeless universe. And that is something which is very difficult to believe for me. And that is the reason why I have developed recently a theory in which the events are due to the instability of the dynamics itself and not to the measuring process which introduces a subjectivistic element into the theory. You see, our classical idea was that molecules are colliding at random, you know, like dust particles. How would they produce coherence? And now we see that non-equilibrium can produce coherence, can produce structures, can produce very complex patterns, and which permit us to see, to understand, I would say, much better the type of structures which we see in the world around us. Time appears always as a result of an incomplete description. In other words, we now see a much more coherent universe in which all degrees of freedom of the universe are in some way connected. And therefore we have flows of information which are going on there and which are expanding encompassing more and more degrees of freedom. I cannot go into the mathematics of this, but I want to say it's a little like a universe of communication. That flowing out of information is not the same as recollecting information. The two directions of time, flowing from few degrees of freedom to many, or recollecting from many and trying to go back to few, becomes quite different processes. And that is already the end of the mechanistic representation, because in the mechanistic representation, to go from a point A to a point B is the same as to go from B to A. That's true for the interaction between the moon and the earth, because the moon is only speaking to the earth, if I can say so, and the earth speaks to the moon. But in the real world, there are so many degrees of freedom which are involved. It's like a multi-actor society. It is something where there's no unique chief who determines what everybody should think. And this type of universe is a universe with irreversibility in the broken time symmetry. So there is one aspect, is how to describe a universe in which we can never follow all the correlations, in which we cannot. We have to give up the idea of omniscience. And that is, of course, related to an enlargement of rationality. The classical rationality was a dream about complete knowledge. Now, we have to accept that we are not seeing the world as perhaps God may see it. We have to see the world as being embedded in the world which we are describing. And that leads to what Herbert Simon has called bounded rationality. Mm-hmm. Bounded rationality in which we have to take into account our own embedding in the world which we describe. So I would say this leads to new problems, new very fundamental problems in science. There's a science of the incomplete, a science of what we know only to some extent. You know, we are like in front of the ocean. Our forerunners were very naive. They would say, well, the ocean is maybe perhaps very deep, but we shall be able to explore the whole ocean. Now we know we shall explore some layer of the ocean, but we cannot say that this layer means that the ocean can be replaced by the layer. There is still the ocean. So we have to give a good theory of the layer floating on the ocean, which is not the same as to have a universe which would be only related to this layer.